they share the features that are common to all RNA polymerases. So they make RNA 5 prime, 3 prime, they require DNA in that way. They can do the RNA synthesis and all processing.
So, like he said, they can make RNA 5 prime, 3 prime, de novo synthesis. And they're all recessive, you said?
Yeah.
Okay, so I know that in your notes, there's a slide that has RNA polymerase 1, 2, and 3 in terms of eukaryotic polymerases. So can someone tell me what those polymerases are?
So RNA polymerase 1 has only one marker. It's used to make 45S subunits.
Mm-hmm. Because it can transcribe thousands of promoters, this one's subjected to regulation. Does that make sense why it's supposed to be highly regulated? Yeah, okay.
Sorry, can you explain more?
If one polymerase can transcribe thousands of promoters, you want to be able to regulate that promoter. So that it's not transcribing a region of your DNA that you don't want. Does that make sense? Like you only want to be transcribing RNA, and then that RNA is going to be made to ultimately the protein that you want. So you only want to have proteins present when you need them to avoid any like unnecessary use of energy and all that good stuff. RNA polymerase 3. What is that one? How many promoters can that one transcribe? Yes, exactly. So RNA polymerase 3 can transcribe hundreds of promoters. And then it also transcribes genes encoding tRNAs, the 5S rRNA, and other small RNAs. That 5S rRNA is the RNA that ultimately is going to be translated to make 5S subunit. Okay, so what about so one additional note about this is that eukaryotic polymerases contain homologs. All bacterial polymerases. we good on number 11? Does anyone have questions? Okay, number 2. There's a couple of those TF2 proteins, but we just want to know what TF2D and TF2H do. So can someone tell me what TF2D does? And the major or the minor group of DNA? Someone said minor. Who said minor? Yeah, it binds the minor group. Okay, what's the analogous component? We have TF2D in eukaryotes. Yeah. TF2H. What does TF2H do?
It acts as the helicase to open up the promoter and also phosphorylate CTP.
Does it require ATP?
No.
Talking about this earlier, that an easy way to remember what TF2H does, TF2H, the H is also in helicase. So I don't know if that's going to work for you, but it'll work.
I assume for the TF2G, A, and B.
Oh, yeah, DAP.
Yeah, remember the DAP.
Yeah, remember the DAP.
It works.
Okay. Does anyone have questions on number 2? All right. Okay. Number 3. You identify a new transcription factor with 2 subunits A and B. Right? You've analyzed the sequence and you find that subunit A has that B zip domain, but B doesn't. So knowing that subunit A contains that domain, what is subunit A most probable or most likely goal?
What is a
B-zip domain? Does anyone know?
I want to say it's a loosely motif, but I can't start.
Oh, what are all these motifs for?
Binding DNA.
Exactly. So
it's obviously binding DNA.
Okay, so because subunit A contains that domain, subunit A Okay, so if it's a multi, if it's not a monomer, I forgot what the word is. So if subunit A is used to recognize DNA sequences, what do you guys think subunit B does? Telling you that this larger complex that is made of subunit A and B is a transcription factor, then most likely subunit B is likely an activating or inhibiting domain. Yeah, the mediator is a co-activator. Okay, so it's asking us the functions of the tail domain, the head domain, and that CDKA module. So what does the tail domain? Module.